Welcome back, sugar friends, to the Nutcracker. When we last saw each other, the Nutcracker came to life. The Mouse King attacked and a battle began. What will happen next, I wonder? With a wave of my wand, let's turn the page and jump into battle.
Beat the General March, my trusty drummer!
And at once the drummer began to rub-a-dub in the skillfulest way, so that the panes of the cupboard shook and echoed. Now came a crashing and a clattering within, and out sprang the infantry and down onto the lower shelf, where they fell into shining ranks and straightway turned into the pantaloon, who had grown somewhat pale, with a telltale chattering of his long chin, and addressed him in solemn Nutcracker tones.
General, I know your courage and your experience. Here, quickness of eye and decision are all important. To you, I entrust the Command-in-Chief of the Cavalry and the Artillery. You don't need a horse, as you have such long legs, and can gallop along on them well enough. Now attend to your duty.
Now, with flying flags and clanging music, regiment after regiment defiled before Nutcracker. Mary saw how their sugar plum shot plunged into the masses of the Mouse Army, who became powdered all over and put greatly to shame. But particularly, they suffered severe loss from a battery of heavy guns, which had taken up position on Mama's footstool, and boom, poom, boom, kept following out gingerbread nuts among the mice, which did much execution. The mice, however, steadily advanced and even came the length of taking a few of the guns, but still resounded the martial din, ba-boom, pa-boom, ba, till for smoke and dust, Mary could scarcely see what was going on. The mice kept on drawing out fresh forces, while their fire, very well delivered, took effect even as far as the glass cupboard. Clara ran up and down in despair and wrung her hands till they were sore.
Am I to die in my blooming youth? I, the fairest of dolls?
During the hottest of the fight, masses of mouse cavalry had been quietly debauching from under the chest of drawers, and with loud, horrid squeaks, had furiously hurled themselves upon Nutcracker's left wing. But what a resistance they met. Slowly, owing to the nature of the ground, it being difficult to pass the cupboard ledge, had the regiment of Moto figures advanced under the leadership of two Chinese emperors and formed themselves into a hollow square. These spirited, gaily equipped and noble troops fought coolly, courageously and steadily. They did not much avail Nutcracker's army, which, retreat once begun, became more and more completely routed and lost men faster and faster, till the unfortunate Nutcracker, with a very small band of his comrades, was brought to bay close in front of the glass cupboard.
Bring up the reserves! Pantaloon, clown, drummer, where are you?
Closely surrounded by foes, Nutcracker was now in the utmost danger and distress. He would have sprung back into the cupboard, but his legs were too short. Clara lay in a swoon. She could not help him. Soldiers and dragoons galloped over him, and he cried in despair.
A horse! A horse! My kingdom for a horse!
At that moment, two of the enemy's skirmishers seized him by his wooden cloak, and up rushed the Mouse King, squeaking out triumph from all his seven throats.
Oh, my poor Nutcracker!
Mary snatched off her left shoe and violently flung it at the Mouse King, right into the middle of his troops. That moment, all appeared to grow dim and to vanish away, but she felt in her right arm a still sharper pain than before and fell fainting on the floor. When Mary awoke out of her deep sleep, She was lying in her own bed, and the sun appeared shining clear and bright into the room through the windows covered with frost. By her side sat a strange gentleman whom, however, she presently recognised as a surgeon.
She is awake now, Mrs. Stromberg.
Oh, dear mother! Are all the mice gone then? And is good Nutcracker safe?
Don't talk such silly stuff, Mary. What have mice to do with Nutcracker? But you, naughty child, you have given us all a great deal of trouble and anxiety. That comes of children having their own way and not obeying their parents. Last night, you were playing with your toys very late. You grew sleepy, and it may be you were frightened by a mouse jumping out, though there used to be no mice here. Anyhow, you struck your arm against the glass of the cupboard and cut yourself so badly that this gentleman, who has just taken out the bits of glass sticking in your arm, says you might have got a serious injury, or even bled to death, if the glass had cut a vein. Thank God that I awoke in the middle of the night. Then, when I found you not in your bed, got up and went into the parlour. There you lay, senseless, beside the cupboard, and were bleeding fast. I had almost fainted away myself for fright to see you lying among a number of Fred's lead soldiers and other toys and gingerbread men. But the Nutcracker lay on your cut arm, and your left shoe was not far off.
Mother, dear mother, these were the remains of the great fight between toys and mice. And what alarmed me so much was the mice trying to take Nutcracker prisoner, who commanded the toy army. And then I threw my shoe amongst the mice. And after that, I don't know what happened.
Never mind, my dear child. Keep yourself easy. The mice are all gone, and Nutcracker is safe and sound in the cupboard.
Here, Dr. Stelborn came into the room and had a long conversation with the surgeon. Then he felt Mary's pulse, and she could make out that they were talking about fever. She had to lie in bed and take medicine, and this lasted for several days, although, except the pain in her arm, she did not feel much the matter with her. She knew the Nutcracker had come safe out of the battle, and he often appeared as in her dream, speaking quite plainly, but in a very sad voice.
Mary, dearest lady, I am deeply indebted to you, but there is yet more which you can do for me.
Mary thought a great deal over this speech, but had no idea what it might be that she could do for him. She was not able to play much with toys on account of her wounded arm, and if she tried to read or turn over picture books, there came such a strange swimming in her eyes that she had to leave off. So time passed slowly for her, and she had scarcely patience to wait for the twilight hour, which came so welcome. For then her mother sat on the bed a while and read or told her such pretty stories. One evening, her mother had just finished the most entertaining history of Prince Charming when the door opened, and in came Godfather Drosselmyer with these words.
Now I must really see for myself how my sick and wounded Mary is getting on.
Godfather Drosselmyer, you were so ugly. I saw you very well, sitting over the clock and covering it with your wings to prevent it from striking loudly, not to scare away the mice. I heard you very well calling to the Mouse King. Why did you not come to help Nutcracker and me, you ugly Godfather Drosselmyer?
Whatever is the matter with you, dear Mary?
Then, out of nowhere, Godfather Drosselmyer made some very queer faces and snarled out a sort of sing-song, thus.
Pay pendulum tick tock, clock clock, click click, hammer goes dong ding, hour rings ting ting, hunter lay, mouse king, owl spreads light wing, toys may dance and sing, clock strikes out ting ting, all the clocks click click, pendulum tick tick, click click, burr purr, beam boom, burn burr, ding dong, so ends my song.
Mary stared at Godfather Drosselmyer with eyes opened to their widest, for he looked quite different and even much uglier than his usual self, and moved his right arm up and down like a puppet pulled by strings. He would have really terrified her if her mother had not been there, and if presently Fred, having slipped in meanwhile, had not burst out into a loud laugh.
Oh, Godfather Drosselmyer, you are so funny today. You are going on exactly like my old jumping jack, which I threw away behind the stove a long time ago.
Dear Mr. Counsellor, this is a strange kind of fun. What may be the meaning of it?
Dear me, my good woman, don't you remember my pretty clockmaker song? I am in the way of singing it always to my patients like Mary. Mary, my dear, you must not be offended if I have not cut out all the Mouse King's 14 eyes. But that is out of the question. And indeed, of it, I am going to give you a great pleasure.
With this, the counsellor put his hand into his pocket, and what he now slowly, slowly drew forth was no other than the Nutcracker, whose lost teeth he had very cleverly set in firm again and mended his broken jaw. Mary cried out for joy, and her mother said with a smile,
"You see now how well Godfather Drosselmyer meant by your Nutcracker."
"That you must own, Mary. And you must own also that Nutcracker has not grown quite so straight as he might have done, and that his looks can't be called handsome. If you care to hear it, I will tell you how this ugliness came into his family. Or perhaps you already know this history of Princess Perlipat, of the witch Mousikins, and of all the skillful clockmaker."
"Just listen, Godfather Drosselmyer. You are putting Nutcracker's teeth right enough, and his chin is no more so wobbly. But why is his sword gone? Why have you not given him a sword?"
"Hey! You fuss and find fault about everything, youngster. What business of mine is Nutcracker's sword? I have healed his body, and he can get a sword for himself if he pleases."
"That's true. If he is a brave fellow, he will soon manage to find weapons."
"Well, Mary, tell me if you know the story of Princess Perlipat."
"Ah, no. Do tell us it, dear Godfather Drosselmyer. Do tell us."
"I hope, dear Mr. Counsellor, that your story is not such a creepy one as those you usually tell are."
"On the contrary, what I am going to have the honour to lay before you is very amusing."
"Do tell us! Oh, do, dear Godfather!"
And the Counsellor thus began his tale. Over to you, Counsellor Drosselmyer.
"The story of the hard nut. Perlipat's mother was the wife of a king, that is a queen. And Perlipat herself was a born princess from the moment of her birth. The king went wild for joy over his lovely little daughter, and she lay in the cradle. In his exultation, he danced and whirled about on one leg and cried out over and over again,
Hurrah! Has anybody ever seen anything more beautiful than my Perlipatkin?
No, darling, never.
But indeed it was not to be denied that in all the world there could be no more beautiful child than Princess Perlipat. Her little face seemed to be woven out of delicate lily white and rose red silk. Her eyes were brightly sparkling blue, and it was pretty to see how her hair curled like shining threads of gold. Besides, Perlipat had brought into the world two small rows of pearly teeth, with which an hour or two after her birth, she bit the High Chancellor's finger as he bent down to examine her features closely, so that he shrieked loudly.
Oh, Gemini!
The raptured nation recognized that wit, spirit, and intelligence all at once dwelt in the little angelic body. In short, everybody was delighted. Only the queen showed herself anxious and ill at ease. Nobody knew why. It seemed strange that she had Perlipat's cradle watched so carefully. You could never guess, dear children, why Perlipat's mother took all these precautions. But I know, and I will tell you now. It happened that once a number of illustrious kings and highly distinguished princes had assembled at the court of Perlipat's father, on whose account there were grand doings and many tournaments, plays, and court balls. The king, in order to prove beyond doubt that he had no lack of gold and silver, was minded for once, in a way, to dip deeply into the crown treasures and bring out something worthy of the occasion. To this end, being privately informed by the chief cook that the court astronomer had announced a propitious day for pork butchering, he ordered a great making of meat puddings and sausages, then jumped into a carriage that he might personally invite the collected kings and princes. Only to a plate of soup. As he put it, the better to enjoy their surprise over the costly banquet. Next, he addressed the Lady Queen in his most winning tone.
It is well known to you, my dear, how fond I am of sausage meat.
Yes, dear. I shall see to it at once.
The Queen knew very well what he would be at. It was just this, that she herself, as she had often done before, should undertake the serious cookery business with her own royal hands. Soon, all the pots and pans steamed with the sweet odors of pudding making, right up to the council chamber, stole his tempting smell, till the king, seized by hearty delight, could not restrain himself.
Excuse me, my lords,
he exclaimed. Flew quickly down to the kitchen, kissed the queen, did a little stirring in the pot with his gold scepter, and then back, well pleased, to the council. Now, it came to that important point when the bacon should be cut into little bits and broiled upon a silver gridiron. The court ladies stood aside, since the queen, out of loyalty and respect for her royal husband, would fain perform this task alone. But as soon as the bacon began to sputter, a tiny whispering voice made itself heard.
too, some of your fry, my sister. Want to taste? I, a queen like yourself. Give me some of the fry.
The queen knew very well that it was Lady Mousikins who spoke this. Lady Mousikins had lived for many years in the king's palace. She declared herself related to the royal family, and that she was queen in the realm of Mousedom. Wherefore, she also kept a great court under the hearthstone. Now, our queen was a kind, good-natured lady, and while she would not exactly recognize Lady Mousikins as a queen and her sister, she had not the heart to grudge her a taste of the nice things on feast days, and called out,
"Come along, Lady Mousikins. You may always taste my bacon."
Thereupon, out popped Lady Mousikins very smartly, jumped onto the hearth, and with her pretty little paws, snapped up one shred of bacon after another, which the queen held out for her. But next came leaping forth all the uncles and cousins of Lady Mousikins. Into the bargain, her seven sons, right mischievous scamps, who threw themselves on the bacon not to be kept off for all the frightened queen could do.
Eat, my son, eat like the king you will become.
Oh, mate.
Luckily, these troublesome guests were hunted away, so that some of the bacon was still saved from their clutches, which had to be equally divided among the sausages. Trumpets and kettle drums resounded as the invited kings and princes came in gorgeous robes of state to the sausage feast, some on white ambling palfreys and some in crystal coaches. The king welcomed them with hearty friendliness and courtesy, then took his place bearing the royal crown and scepter at the head of the table. When the white puddings were first served, it could be seen how his majesty grew always paler, how he raised his eyes. His bosom heaved with sighs. Violent pangs were evidently raging within him. But when they reached a course of black puddings, he sank back in his armchair, sobbing and moaning. He covered his face with his hands. He broke forth into loud lamentation. All present sprang to their feet. The body physician in pain made an effort to feel the king's pulse. He seemed convulsed by some deep, nameless anguish. At length, after many suggestions, after the use of strong remedies, burning of feathers under his nose and such like, his majesty, being so far brought to himself, stammered out almost inaudibly these words.
"Too little bacon."
"Oh, my poor, unhappy royal spouse. What pain you must be suffering. But here you see the guilty one before you. Punish her severely. Lady Mousikins it was, with her seven sons, her uncles, and her cousins, who have eaten up the bacon."
"Oh. I will punish Lady Mousikins for this foul deed. Call the Privy Council."
The Privy Council being summoned, it was resolved to prosecute Lady Mousikins and to confiscate her property. But as the king considered she might meanwhile go on eating his bacon, the matter was at once placed in the hands of the court clockmaker and engineer. This man, who was named exactly like myself, Christian Elias Drosselmyer, undertook by means of a singular piece of statecraft to banish Lady Mousikins and her family forever from the royal palace. Your Majesties, may I present to you my new invention? Mouse traps. When the mouse or the rat steps upon the contraption after smelling this toasted bacon fastened upon a thread, the trap will snap down and get rid of them quickly.
Place them round the castle, Drosselmyer. Save my husband.
However, Lady Mousikins was much too clever not to see through this cunning. But all her warnings, all her lectures were thrown away on her seven sons and many, many of her uncles and cousins who, enticed by the sweet smell of bait, ventured within Drosselmeyer's machine. Then, as soon as they tried to know our ways of Aiken, found themselves trapped by a grating that fell suddenly behind them and delivered to shameful execution in the very kitchen where they had enjoyed such pleasant feasts. With her small band of surviving subjects, Lady Mousikins abandoned the scene of horror. Woe, despair, revenge filled her breast. The courtiers exulted, but the queen was troubled. Knowing the nature of Mousikins, and too well aware that she would not leave her sons and kinsmen unavenged. Indeed, as Her Majesty was one day cooking her husband's favorite meat feast, Lady Mousikins appeared and said,
"My sons, my cousins and kinsmen are dead. Take good heed that the Mouse Queen bite not thy little princess in two. Take good heed."
With this, she went off, and no more seen. But the queen stood so terrified that she let the fricassee fall into the fire. And the second time, Lady Mousikins had spoiled one of the king's favorite dishes, whereat he was very angry. But now, that is enough for this evening. The rest another time.
Please tell us more, Godfather dearest. Please.
Too much at once is not good. More tomorrow.
But do tell us, Godfather Drosselmyer, is it really true that you invented mouse traps?
How can you talk such nonsense?
Am I not a clever clockmaker? Must not mouse traps have been invented somehow or other?
My sweet friends, sadly it is time to leave it there, for when we return, the adventure continues. Will Mousikins triumph over the royal family? Will the king get his meat? Dishes, I mean. And will Christian's trap continue to work? These questions and many more will be answered next time. Until then, farewell. And may you be sprinkled with happiness.